Welcome to Hard Copy, coming to you from Channels TV studios in Abuja. I am Terry Ikumi. Social safety net, national social register, that's the conversation tonight. The announcement by the Vice President, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, on the 20th of January of the federal government's policy to lift 20 million Nigerians out of poverty in the next 2 years has been the topic of various conversations. Professor Osinbajo stated this while flagging off the administration's economic sustainability plan, where he also said the cash transfer scheme will now be facilitated through a wholly technology-based approach called the Rapid Response Register, RRR. So the RRR, according to the presidency, will enable the government to achieve a social security program for at least 20 million Nigerians to be lifted out of poverty within 2 years. Also, according to the VP, 1 million Nigerians are to benefit from the federal government's COVID-19 cash transfer project, which aims to lift the urban poor affected by the pandemic out of poverty. Many Nigerians have been questioning how this will work and what level of transparency will be displayed, especially since it will be done through the National Social Register, whose thoroughness many have questioned. My guest tonight to unravel some of the surrounding issues is Apera Yowa. He is the National Coordinator of the National Social Safety Net Coordinating Office, NASCO. Mr. Yowa, welcome to Hard Copy.
Thank you.
Here's what I want us to do tonight. I want us to speak in the simplest terms that the people for which this federal government programs are designed will understand. So quickly, talk us through this now. The Vice President talked about the cash transfer going through a wholly technology-based process. That's the rapid response, through the rapid response register now. Yeah. How will this work for the poor, the poorest of the poor, who neither have bank accounts or access to technology?
Thank you very much. Maybe if you want me to speak in simplest terms, maybe we'll revert to Pidgin English, which I'm also very comfortable with. But the concept of urban poor is yet another challenging concept that we need to perhaps socialize a little bit. Now, when the pandemic struck, Nigeria, like every other country, closed its economy, closed the country literally, stopping people who had, who would ordinarily every day come out on the streets to sell akara or come out to the more urban areas like Gozape here for bricklaying or for painting jobs or for carpentry jobs. Stop them from moving around. Stop this work. And these people are the ones that live in our suburbs of Orozo, Nyanya, Kubo areas, right? Now, they are not our rural people. They are in the urban areas, peri-urban areas, and this service the urban, more affluent urban areas. Now, these people they are the daily income earners, the informal workforce that we have that spin the engines of growth and the engines of civilizations in our cities. Now, these individuals were without jobs, without their daily income, and so without a means of livelihood. These were the most impacted. When you go back to our rural areas, most of our rural areas were still relatively okay in terms of the farmers were still able to go to their farms in the more laid-back rural areas that were not as stringent in terms of closure. So life was going on. So the most impacted, and this is also globally, the most impacted people when you lock up the economy like that are your informal work sector, the daily income earners, the gardeners in the hotel. In fact, your cleaners, I'm very sure most of them lost their jobs, even though I'm not exposing you.
Yeah,
stopped coming to work, for instance, the stylists and folks like that. Now, those are the people we're talking about. Now, some of them have been able to bounce back, some have not.
It would be nice if you could just tell us how this technology will be employed in reaching out to this urban poor, which you talk about.
Yeah. So once we had identified these locations, the urban political wards in the country, about 2,640 political wards are classified urban within the definition of what is urban and rural. Once we classified that using other statistical information in the Living Standards Survey that was released by the Bureau of Statistics, we know the estimates of the people living in each of these locations. What we're then doing is to send out text messages to this environment, and the people within those environments will then respond to the text message that will take them to a portal to register. And this is done by cell phone. And it's been simplified that you use not necessarily an Android or a smartphone, but any cell phone that you have with you, as low as a 1,000 naira phone, can give you access to send back the text messages in response to this.
Now, so would these be people that are captured in the social register?
No, these are not people that will be captured in social register, even though there's a possibility that those who are already in the social register will also respond to these text messages.
So be clear on how you're getting the data of this 1 million people who are going to benefit from this COVID emergency fund.
Purely from the text messages that were sent out, the respondents will take that data, will synthesize the data, will take it back into the field and validate these individuals. We will then go back to the streets where they have registered. We identify the individual. You send this text message, you're Mr. A, this is where you live. You fit the criteria we're looking for. You are an artisan, you are an informal worker, you are a low-income earner. We'll take all that bio data and information of you. We also take if you have a bank account or not, and your means of identification. We'll take all this information. And then we will then validate this information and clean the data, will generate a payroll from it. So everyone that its information is picked, you will have a bank account number. If you don't have a bank account number, a virtual account is created, or a mobile wallet is created wherein your monies are paid electronically.
Is this a phase by phase thing? Because I understand that it's just 1 million people and they will get their money for 6 months.
Yes. So 1 million people get their money for 6 months, and as funds allow, more people are taking in. Now, the Mr. Vice President talked about the Social Security, which is a broad-based, much more bigger initiative. But what is happening is the Rapid Response Register is creating that database and that platform that identifies these individuals and bring them onto the register, wherein they are also open to the Social Security program that the federal government is currently working to put on board.
You know, one of the questions that a lot of people would ask is the geographic distribution of the poorest of the poorest. You'd like to put them, and as far as this 1 million people who will benefit go, and because it's linked to the COVID-19 pandemic, some would say that there are certain geographical areas in this country that have not gone through the pains of the COVID-19 pandemic lockdown as some others. How would you balance this from state to state?
So That's why I made reference to taking other statistical information like the National Living Standards Survey. You know, the NLSS that was released by Bureau of Statistics earlier in 2020, which was about April or May, did categorize this country from the poor to the poorest state. Now, using that poverty head count, we are able to estimate exactly the total number of poor and vulnerable in each state.
No, that's a general assertion.
Yeah.
This fund is for COVID-19 intervention.
Yes.
Yes? And there are states that did not go into lockdown, so they were not affected by the lockdown. As you've rightly pointed out, that there were some artisans and small businesses that were affected by the lockdown, and those are the ones who will benefit. So how do you sieve them?
Each and every state of the Federation is impacted one way or the other for the lockdown. Now, you also recall, or you know, that in Abuja here, most of the artisans that we're talking about are from other states of the Federation in Abuja.
That reside in them, FCT.
Yes, yeah, that reside in FCT. And some of them, because of the pandemic and because of the closure of the economy, had to go back to their states where they are closer to their family. They went back without jobs, and they didn't have access to jobs. So those individuals still reside in all the states of the Federation. And that is what we're doing. And when you look at the categorization of the political world, you will see that in most of the urban settlements, most of the target groups are in most of the states that we are adversely impacted by the pandemic, Lagos, FCT.
Permit me to come in here.
Yes.
Here's why this is going to be a big topic of conversation. You know, when the lockdown was instituted, some states went into lockdown, others did not. And when palliatives were being distributed, it didn't go to every state. It didn't start with every state, at least. There were some states that were directly affected that got their palliatives first because they had gone into lockdown. So I don't know if this has been a consideration yet, but if this is a COVID-19 intervention fund and it's going to target just 1 million people, I think many people would say that it would be advisable to reach out to people who have actually, especially geographically, been affected by the COVID-19 pandemic.
Okay, so when the pandemic started, we closed down four states, right?
Yes.
That was FCT, Lagos, Ogun, and I think Kano, right? However, as the time went on, other states also joined the lockdown. So Rivers, Benue, and all the other states came on board. Now, if you look through it, all through this period, only very few states, maybe one or two or three. So when you balance it, the fraction of the states that were not locked down are not really many. Every other person was affected. And like we said, these people still migrated back to their states. Now, if you want to answer that question, it is first a given that every single individual that lives in our urban areas in this country was impacted or affected in one way or the other.
Let's stick with the social register now, because I think it's one thing that's generated a lot of reactions. And a direct question would be, how do people get enrolled in the social register? How do you determine the poorest of the poor?
From the point of view of the social register, Nigeria adopts what you call a community-based targeting system, wherein the community members will sit in plenary and decide, first define within the context of that community what poverty is, then determine who is poor within the context of their definition. And then once they determine who is poor within that community, the community will then agree. So what we then do to give proper voice to everyone, we separate them into three focus group discussions. One for the youth, one for the male adult, and one for the female. Each of these groups will define what poverty means within their context, right? And then they will then choose which of the families within the community is deemed poor to fit that definition. So the women will make their list, the male will make their list, the youth will make their list. Then the three will come into plenary and they will harmonize the list. Once they harmonize this list, the community will select one male and one female who will sign off on this list for our community. Here our identified poor, and then one copy of that list will remain with the community. We will take the other list and then come back and enumerate these individuals into the social register. Then it will undergo a lot of process of data cleaning and data validation. Once we get to a final stage that we are satisfied that this is clean data, you have the right information in it and all of that, we also set up other processes to double check that this is actually accurate, including a back check, where a select team will drop into this community to cite the community list and then walk back to see that those that were selected by the community are actually those who are in the social register.
But I think it's very important to talk about how you verify that list in a manner that the people who are on that list are not family members of the people who have submitted that list, or friends, or as some would say it, party loyalists, because I know that you interact with state governments to get this social register.
Yes, so for the social register, you have, and indeed also the rapid response register, you have in each state planning ministry, there is the state operations and coordinating unit whose responsibility is to generate this register. Now, how do we ensure that it's actually the community that selects? We have a team of civil society organizations that have been engaged. And like we know, civil society organizations are the voice of the people. They live in the community. They are community representatives. So we have them across the country who go in to monitor and validate and send information to us. We, okay, of course, we have other accountability structures that ensure the
integrity. We will stick with the social register when we come back. Please stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Hard Copy. My guest is Apera Yowa. He is the National Coordinator of the National Social Safety Net Coordinating Office, NASCO. And we're looking at the social safety net and the social register. We were talking just before the break about verifying the authenticity of the register as the list as submitted by community leaders. And you had mentioned the three groups you had talked about. The elderly, young male, and young female.
No, it's the male adults.
Male adults.
The female adults, and then the youths.
In what category does the do physically challenged people fall?
They fall if where they constitute a critical mass in the community, it's a fourth group. However, if not, they fall into their age category as they are.
Do they have special considerations at any point?
Yes, they do.
Okay.
In the sense that when you have a critical mass, yes, they take. And till today, we have about 1.7 million persons living with disability in the social register.
Let's move forward now. And in moving forward with a new plan, it is always important to look back at the old plan and assess how far it's come. It's important to know how projects like the NPOW performed. How many people have been lifted out of poverty since the coming of the National Social Register about 6 years ago?
We've not really done an impact study.
6 years gone?
Yes. Of course, as startup, there are teething problems of startup. And within the context of our country, and being a federation, we need to, you first enter a memorandum of understanding with state governments. Until October 2019, we didn't have all the states sign that MOU and onto the program. And so until that time, we were still in a few states. For a long time, since 2016, 2015 that we started, up to 2018, we had only about 20 states that we were working with. Now, gradually, other states came on board. So the 6 years interval, you will see that some states, like Ebonyi, for instance, Ebonyi, it's only about 10 months old on the social register. In fact, the advent of the pandemic, we didn't have data from Ebonyi, we didn't have data from Ogun.
But how do you make progress without knowing the level of success of a particular program and then initiate another one?
The impact study that we've not done does not mean we cannot gauge the impact of the study. We have success stories and empirical evidence from the field that suggests to us the amount of progress that we have made. Now on the social register side, you will see the growth that we have made from when in April 1st, 2018. We were just about 360,000 poor and vulnerable households on the social register. Today, that social register has grown to 6 million households.
Mr. Yowa, where's the social register?
The social register is domiciled within our office, within the servers, and it's also accessible to the extent that the data security laws will allow.
When you say accessible by who? Because I think one of the questions that Nigerians have been asking is, we've only heard that about 6 million households have been registered, about 24 million Nigerians have been captured, but there is nowhere that this information is accessible. It's not available anywhere. So how do you deal with the issue of transparency and gaining the trust of Nigerians if they can't see this, they only hear it?
First, the social register starts with the community list. So for every community that we have, there's a community list domiciled in that community.
Which and you would eventually filter.
Yes. Our filtration never touches or decreases the number on this agreed list. Our filtration is in the quality of the data in taking the right information, but the numbers will remain the same. Secondly, in every state office, there's a state social register domiciled at the Ministry of Planning and accessible to every individual. What we do at the national level, it's actually a collation of the state social register. It is a social register of the state, owned by the state, generated by the state, and maintained by the state. What we do at the national level is to collate the mirror image of these registers into a national social register and have the aggregate numbers. Even at that, we have a huge database of this information that's accessible on request when you sign the MOU with us in terms of accessing the data. Remember, the social register is an information gateway for potential beneficiaries into any social intervention program. So if you have a social intervention program targeting the poor and vulnerable, the social register is a place you come for information.
But does it not bother you that every time a program like this comes out, Nigerians become skeptical? They don't trust the process because they don't see anything. And most importantly, you hear people say that it is almost impossible to put 10 billion naira across states or to a particular community, and then nobody can say, I'm a beneficiary of this project. How do you react to things like that?
Oh, first, it was just in the news last week or 2 weeks ago. A group of women in a village in Kwara State contributed money from the 5,000 naira they get from the federal government cash transfer to building a classroom block and employing teachers to teach their students. The Kwara State governor went there and gave them an award and refunded their money. Last year, the story was widely taken in the news, including channels. In fact, channels was the one that broadcast the story more in Jigawa State, where women who were collecting this cash transfer contributed money and bought a car that is helping them move women, pregnant women, from their village to the hospital for giving birth.
And we can confidently say that these monies came from the 5,000 naira
contributions. Exactly. And for both the social register and the rapid response register, we have the geo coordinates of each individual resident that we have the information. And you can trace this individual, you can put a face to this individual, you can find out from this individual at any time.
I'm curious, as many Nigerians, how difficult is it to make information available, believable information, for Nigerians to confidently say, this is what we see and we can trust the process? Here's why I say that. This question has arisen so much that even the Minister of State, Minister of Labour, has said that the Special Public Works Programme will be made public so people can see the project, see the people, see the their community members who are involved in the project. This is just to prove transparency. That has not been, that's not visible yet, but why is it so difficult to make the, just to say, why is it so difficult to make the National Social Register available for people to see and verify the names? I mean, I could easily verify the names of people in my community if I see those names.
If you take a drive to your community, you will cite your community
in
list.
This era of technology, you want me to drive all the way to my community to get information that I should
now,
be able to
see,
get at
there,
a click
there are data
of a button.
Laws, right? It's just called NCC that you want the database of phone individuals with phone numbers and their details. You won't get it. It's against the data security laws to give your personal information out to the public, right?
This is a social safety program.
A social safety net also has some data, some guidelines around it, right? Mm. But it is accessible to the extent possible that our data security laws allow. Now, your question will be, I'll display it on a website, a whole list of Nigerians that are on the social register, their names, their ages, their vocation, their level of education, to attain that level of transparency.
Possible?
It is possible. But I'm going to take your information as a staff of channels with your vocation, what you earn, where you live, and everything about you on the social net.
I don't see how there's an issue in this age of social media where everybody's information is already out there. What's the security risk in that? But let's I think that's something that your office
perhaps
might,
we need to look at.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But before we go, this administration in 2016 came up with a number of social investment programs that were expected to take Nigerians out of poverty, at least a number. 2 years later, we became the poverty capital of the world. What is it about this new plan, this new project, that should get Nigerians hopeful or excited?
The first instance is that the social investment program and the deliberate attempt of this administration to budget 500 billion, it's by far the most ambitious investment into the poverty question of this country.
Well, sadly, we're out of time. I think that this is a conversation that I wish we could continue.
We should find another time.
We should find time
to
speak on it. Thank you so much for coming to speak with us on Hard Copy.
Thank you very much.
Well, that's it on Hard Copy tonight. Remember to send feedback to the email address and social media handle on your screen. This and past episodes can be found on our website, channelstv.com. You can also find the podcasts as well. I am Terry Ikumi. Goodbye.